Today we're talking about Argentina's economy. Because, well, it's rockier than a list of memorable Sylvester Stallone movies. Recently, they asked for help to solve their problem, and the devil was busy, so they made a deal with the next worst thing.
Most Argentines are shocked with the news that the government is seeking financial help from the International Monetary Fund.
The International Monetary Fund. A group that is essentially what would happen if you let a payday loan shark run an international non-profit. You got a nice country here. You give me control of your budget and I'll lend you 30 bucks. So first, what the heck happened in Argentina? Because their economy has had more sudden of a collapse than Attorney General Schneiderman. Although, we should have listened a little bit more carefully. Wait, did he say he was going to fight for women or for women? Yes, just a few months ago, it was all Buenos Aires for Argentina. According to Quartz magazine, last year they successfully sold 100-year bonds, which is truly an accomplishment. Buying a 100-year bond is like marrying a comedian who's just starting out. You gotta be pretty darn sure they're gonna make it, or you're gonna lose quite a bit of money. So first, let's go over that crazy bit of faith people had in Argentina. Because, well, it was kinda weird. As the Financial Times reported,
in the next few weeks, the South American country is planning to make the most anticipated sale of emerging market debt so far this year, when it issues sovereign bonds for the first time in more than a decade. Who would want to buy bonds issued by a serial defaulter with a sizable budget deficit and nagging inflation worries? Well, everyone, apparently.
Oh man, is she really just nagging the heck out of those Argentinian bonds? Serious serial defaulter with climbing inflation and a large deficit? Well, I'll have to think about it, but if you really insist, I'll lend you all the money I can. Furthermore, this was coming from the same channel that had just a year ago reported,
Argentina's defaulted for the second time in 13 years.
Well guys, looks like a great investment. Let me just sell my investments in the Syrian real estate market so I can jump right in. So yes, Argentina seems to default to defaulting. Doing it so often, I think even Puerto Rico is telling them to be more reliable. So why would investors look at a country that has defaulted twice in the last 13 years and think, well, surely they won't default anytime in the next 100 years? They probably have gotten it all out of their system. Well, actually, here's the Financial Times again? Man, those people must really want to visit Argentina.
He's recently repaid the debts that have been fought over for 13 years. These debts are in dollars, so you don't need to worry about the inflation side of things. And where else can you get an emerging market, frontier market story where there's solid reform going on? So 7.5% sure as hell beats sort of 6% you get for Brazil, which is heading the other way, or 1% in the States.
All right, so let's break that down, because there was a weird amount of optimism pushing Argentine investment, to the point where the country couldn't have lived up to the hype if they had invented a cure for cancer. 2 years ago, there were plenty of reforms going on in Argentina, with the highlights being corporate tax cuts while hiking up taxes for Social Security, pension cuts for public sector retirees, lowering the amount the government can control domestic purchasing of foreign currencies, liberalizing trade, and making public utilities more expensive. This is what really emphasizes a potential problem with being a small country that needs to borrow money, because I think it's safe to say that these actions probably aren't great for the average Argentinian. But do you think this guy really cares about them?
You can probably bet on this guy or something like him lasting long enough for these bonds to make sense.
Wow, I'm sorry, but that was just truly moving words. I had no idea you cared about this administration that much. Now, it may seem like I'm criticizing him for this position, but if he cared about the well-being of Argentina, I certainly am not going to give him my money. His job is to make sure that at the end of 100 years or 10 years or however long the bond lasts, the government pays him back. And if you're not a massive reliable country like the US, you show your commitment by doing everything you can in the private sector to spur on revenue, rather than focusing on the public sector, which spurs on expenses. Now to his second point.
These debts are in dollars, so you don't need to worry about the inflation side of things.
This is huge for bond investors and potentially terrible for countries. much like everything else associated with the government bond market. Getting your bonds in dollars means that you don't have to care about the local currency, which is great considering that recently in Argentina we've seen
the peso, which this year has lost 15% of its value against the US dollar.
Now, we'll get into that later, but for now, just imagine you're an investor who bought Argentinian bonds a year ago, and the bond's value didn't change. Considering the fact that the peso dropped 15% to the dollar last year, you would lose 15% of your investment if you had chosen to invest with the peso instead of the dollar. Alright, so Argentinian bonds were selling like heroin-laced hotcakes because of the pro-market reforms and the fact that they were dealing in dollars. Well, every party comes to an end, and in this case, inflation was the drunk guy who smashed the vase. In Argentina at this time, the economy was more faith-based than the Pope's divinity. Argentina needed two things, citizens' faith in the currency and investors' faith in the country. The first real problem actually happened when it was announced that
the peso is now the worst performing currency in the region this year, and the central bank adjusted interest rates three times, up to 40%, to prevent a further slide in the currency.
Now that might sound super inconsequential. Oh my gosh, the Fed raised the key interest rate to 40%? But when the Fed did something similar in the US, it got a ton of news coverage.
The Federal Reserve raises its benchmark federal funds rate 0.25%, with the federal funds rate range now at 1.5 to 1.75%.
That is the definition of boring news. But what is the key interest rate, and why is Argentina so much higher than every other country? Because their interest rate is the largest in the world, and they're not doing it just because they want their own page in the Guinness Book of World Records. It's because inflation is a really weird problem if you really want to understand it, and the key interest rate is a great way to fight inflation. So first, what causes inflation? A question I've actually been asked by my friends, because we're awesome. Inflation is influenced by three other factors: how much cash is printed, how fast that money is moving, and how the GDP is doing. Alright, so the government could start destroying currency, but well, you know how that would look. Well, in reality, they'd sell bonds and in effect absorb the currency from people buying them, but Argentina was in no position to be selling bonds. Instead, you have to try to slow down how fast people are using money. And while this might sound certifiably crazy, you need to slow down economic growth, which is where you get debates like,
are we doing so good? Is the economy so robust that it's time to start hiking rates?
Well, the Fed's in a tough spot. Remember, it has to target inflation as well as unemployment, so to speak. And inflation has been heating up. And the latest CPI report was rather disturbing.
That debate was over whether the US Fed should raise interest rates, because rooms full of wealthy people are starting to worry about whether the US economy is overheating. In theory, if it were overheating, we'd raise the interest rates, banks would lend less money, and people would save and invest more, and inflation would die down. Alright, great. Now we get that that would work, but good luck explaining that to the people of Argentina. Hey guys, our inflation is too large, so we need to wreck the economy. Sound good? Even worse, if you're an investor and the entity you're investing in has changed their business plan to self-sabotage for the sake of fighting inflation, well, you're not gonna have a good time. Especially because those bonds are in dollars and not pesos, so investors don't really give a darn about the fate of the local currency. So, alright, that didn't inspire confidence amongst Argentinians, which led to a massive sell-off of the Argentinian peso. And that would have been avoided if lowering the amount the government can control domestic purchasing of foreign currencies. Unfortunately, unlike what happened 2 years ago when the value of the peso was somewhat regulated, this is what happened to how many pesos you could use to buy a dollar. Wow, alright, that's not what you want to see if you owe money in US dollars. So let's talk about those currency controls, because that is key to understanding the problems Argentina is facing today.
On day one after the end of a four-year policy of currency controls that has choked the economy, expectation and apprehension in Argentina The immediate result, close to a 30% drop in Argentina's currency, the peso.
Oh wow, choking the economy? Well, that doesn't sound good. What does that mean though? Well, before he made those reforms, the Argentinian Federal Reserve had pegged the value of the peso at about 10 pesos per dollar. While in reality, its value is about 14 pesos per dollar. Now, this is one of those so stupid it might work solutions. Boss, our currency is worth less than we want it to be worth. What should we do? Well, we could just tell people it's worth more, pretend it's worth more, and see how the chips fall. So how would a Federal Reserve artificially maintain the value of a failing currency? Well, as you can probably imagine, it's weird. They buy money. 5 years ago, this was reported.
Julio Duran wanted to give $5 to each one of his two grandchildren. But because of the government's latest measures, he was unable to buy them.
Yes, until very recently in Argentina, you couldn't buy US dollars. Which sounds pretty odd. I do know that, according to CNN Money, 90% of US dollars have trace amounts of cocaine on them. But still, you can't just ban them. So why would you want to keep US dollars out? Well, they had decided to control their currency in the most totalitarian way possible. And not to sound evil, but in this case, totalitarian isn't bad, just all-powerful. Alright, so you want to keep your currency high with the goal of combating inflation, but you don't want to hurt your economy. Remember, the three factors are influencing inflation are GDP growth, how fast the money is moving, and how much of your currency is out there. Well, before the current leadership, the Argentinian Federal Reserve was using foreign currency to buy up pesos to make them more valuable domestically. As you can imagine, this is not exactly great for foreign currency reserves. And consistent listeners, think about the recent episode I did on trade when you hear this clip.
Thursday's report said the US dollars obtained in recent months helped Buenos Aires make corrections to the exchange rate and reduce the growing deficit coming from the interchange of goods and services.
The Argentine government needed foreign currency in order to keep buying their local currency. And yes, it's as absurd as it sounds. So why ban buying US dollars? Well, if your currency is artificially worth more than it actually is, who in their right mind wouldn't sell it consistently? If you offer to consistently sell me Bitcoin worth $1,000 on the market for $800, I'm gonna buy and then sell at a rate of $200 a pop. Although, with how weird the world of Bitcoin is, I wouldn't put it past them. Alright, so why all the effort? Well, to fight inflation, which it seems might have been at least somewhat successful in the short term. So why does scarcity increase the value of money? Well, to put it simply...
Alright, there's a nuclear holocaust. I'm the last man on Earth. Would you go out with me?
The less of something there is, the more valuable it becomes. If it's a positive. I mean, it's not like the last copy of the Macarena is going to be worth $1 million or anything, but you get my point. This spending scheme was able to keep the Argentinian peso protected from devaluation. Until...
His government has lifted currency controls that date back 4 years. And the value of the Argentine peso fell sharply after the announcement. And now the move is sparking broader concerns.
Hey, at least we know it was working. So this brings us to today and that International Monetary Fund loan we were talking about from the beginning. From everything I've told you, it doesn't really seem like the solution to the problem is, let's dump more money on everything. In fact, in an odd way, that is the problem, and the reason Argentina is trying to slow economic growth. So why is Argentina trying to get money from the IMF? Well, you remember how I said that Argentina has liberalized its currency exchange market? That was a little bit of an exaggeration. Because the IMF recently said in a statement, Argentina has a floating market-determined exchange rate, and we fully support that. The exchange rate should continue to be determined by market forces, with the central bank continuing to use all the policy tools that are at its disposal. So yes, you can now buy foreign currencies in Argentina, But the Argentine Federal Reserve and Central Bank are using all of their foreign reserves to remove local currency from the market and keep that currency's value up. They recently spent $408 billion on pesos and are continuing to do that with help from the IMF. In exchange, the IMF is demanding that they make deeper cuts to public spending in order to ensure that they will be able to more likely pay back loans. So, there you have it. Argentina, a country that is not going through the literal apocalypse problems of Venezuela, but encountering problems that are actually solvable and can teach a lot about the role of the central bank and IMF and currencies. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hello, YouTube. If you want to support nonpartisan comedic reporting, please subscribe to my channel and like below. Thank you for watching.